So I'm recording, but nobody will appear in the recordings. We actually only take few bits out of the recordings, thanks to Eva, who's not here today, but so that the idea is that some of this useful practical stuff can stay in some recorded format, and we can share it with you all, and also with those who couldn't make it. So let me share my window. So for today, the first part, so if you are not into medical images or medical processing, there's lots of people at Alto who work with brain images, brain time series, but also other types of medical slash health related data, then it's okay if you stay around just for the first part. Then for those of you who are more interested in these medical images, processing, DICOM and other stuff, you can stay for the rest. We're not too many today, so it's also good that we can kind of, adapt what we need to do to what are your actual needs, so that if it's clear that something is not needed, then maybe, we can just talk about it, but we don't really need to go deeper into it. So as usual, there is the HackMD, which is our asynchronous chat. It is linked at the very top of the course webpage, but for your convenience, I also paste it here in our Zoom chat. And here it comes. So just to stretch your fingers a bit, in this HackMD for today, I wrote two icebreaker, two questions. That if you remember how it works, you go to the link, you click on the pencil that I'm now showing with my mouse. I hope you see my screen. And then with this, you can basically, find a spot in the HackMD and start writing. So the first question that I'm asking you is, what is your workflow? Meaning that you start your day, that you need to work with some data that you collected or that someone gave you. So how does it work? Is it that you open a laptop or a workstation, or you log in to some remote computer? And is your data stored locally? Is your data stored remotely? Are you using Linux? Like your average day, you might be using everything, Linux and Mac and Windows, but the idea here is that you can kind of write down your workflow, like the example that I listed here. Is it that this thing happen locally? You basically don't need the internet, or do you do everything in some remote machine computer? Because there are different, we all have very different types of kind of working with our research data. And not all of this workflow that are possible would be suitable for data that it cannot be anonymized. So think of your average day. Where do you keep your data? Do you keep it in some Google Drive, Dropbox, SharePoint, Scratch for those who use Python? Where do you keep your code, if you have code? So your daily, then that today you are going to do some work with your data. So how do you actually do it? I understand, of course, that in some days you might work locally, in some other days you might work remotely, but just think on what is the most common, workflow that you have with data. So I'm not talking about, you can answer your emails in the best way you want, but here we're more talking about that you have some data, can be interviews, can be some tabular data, brain images, whatever, and they imagine they have to work with this data. So how would you work? Okay, I see many of you writing. I'll let you write a bit. And then, if for those who already finished writing the first icebreaker, we could have a look at also the icebreaker 2, where basically what we are working on is that we have already started kind of collecting all these materials and links and the video demonstration that I gave, so that we can create a page under alto.fi where we could kind of list all these techniques that we explore for anonymizing or de-identifying or pseudonymizing personal data. And specifically, you know, you can think this as a to-do list, because I already noticed that for example, this Filmora tool that we used last time, I would say that half of the people in the room had some troubles installing it or downloading it or using it. So maybe it's not the best option. I understand that there are other tools for some at Alto, like Adobe Premiere, but even that is not an option for everyone, because at least at School of Science, I wasn't able to run it. So we need, you know, there's still some work to do. So I want to find a tool that is kind of, you know, for everyone, where we could do this video blurring without coding. And then someone was asking about the background blurring of videos. And so I didn't find any graphical tool. I don't know, of course, if things like Premiere would do it. I can't test it because I'm not able to run Premiere. But at least I found some Python package that is able to blur the background of the videos. So I'm gonna add also that to that page, because it might be quite useful if you are interviewing somebody, that, you know, you can at least blur, you know, the people then watching, they don't know if this person is, I don't know, in Otaniemi or in some office room and things like that. So if you can also write here in the HackMD this type of other things that we could add to this summary page, that would be useful for you and also for others at Alto who couldn't make it to the course. And I can see some people writing already. Maybe we can quickly have a look, because we're not too many today, at these workflows that you wrote down. So I store my data locally, online, on Dropbox, Teams, and G Drive, depending who I'm working with. That's okay. But you understand basically that if you were working with personal data, maybe Teams is okay, but maybe I wouldn't even keep it there. So there are better options. Like in this case, I wouldn't recommend any of these systems to actually store personal data. So here somebody's writing, I store personal data and anonymized data in Google Drive. For restricted data, use the Alto servers of the workstation allocated for the specific data. I do not use any virtual machines. Okay, so this is good when it comes to the data. G Drive, just to make sure in case, like, do you all know that Alto has a Google Drive option? The so-called Google Suite. So if you're using the Alto Google Drive, then you can use it for personal data, to store personal data, although it's not kind of recommended, not because there's something wrong with Google, you know, let's not go there, but let's say that for being cautious, it's so easy with one button to share the data that is stored in Google Drive, that maybe if something sensitive, Google Drive is not the best option. And of course, I'm not talking about your own Google Drive. If you use, you know, if you have a Gmail account and you use that Google Drive for personal data, well, in the terms of service, Google can actually read what's in there. They have, Google has the right. So if you're storing personal data on Google Drive, you must use the Alto Google Drive option. And when it comes to this, this person wrote that they do not use any virtual machines, which basically would mean that they use their local machine. Now, I don't know if their local machine means that there is their own computer at home, or it's an Alto laptop that they receive from Alto IT, or if it's or if they go to the office. So you understand, of course, that if it's your own computer and you are the administrator, then if you do not take care of updates or security issues, then there is the, you know, chance, maybe theoretical chance, that that personal data that you might store might leak. Alto laptops that are given to Alto employees, they're all managed from remote, and they all have this type of cloud disks, so that, you know, in the worst case that somebody steals your laptop, you can still kind of lock the laptop so that no personal data is leaked. And instead, if you come to the office, that's, you know, a little bit more secure, because it gets more difficult to steal a machine from the office. But, and also there it follows the same idea that we have this kind of cloud storage and not physically. You know. Long story short, just in case somebody's mentioned it, do not use, you know, USB sticks or external drives, especially if they're not encrypted, because that's the easiest way to basically leak personal data. Yeah, well, maybe this is specific for a case. Well, YouTube also has the right to look at the content of your video, even if it's not listed. It's in their terms of service. Local and remote. Well, okay, I guess we kind of cover it all. Basically, if we go back to the course page, there is a nice lecture. Let me see if I linked it. Yeah, yes. So this is from last autumn. There's a YouTube link here. Let me fix the formatting a bit. So there is this lecture from the same series that you're actually watching this, by Ilari Lahtenmäki, who works here at Alto. And so there's a YouTube video that you can watch, and it's all about basically, you know, how to store and share personal data at Alto. So I understand, of course, that some of you here are not from Alto, but at least this is the solution. Most likely your university has similar solutions. And here there's also the slides. So yeah, in general, when it comes to these workflows, if we think of, you know, without going more to what you wrote on the HackMD, these workflows are important, because in the case that we would be able to fully anonymize our personal data, so we are in the case that it's not anymore personal data, then with anonymous data, you can, you know, use it anywhere. There might still be some sensitive content in your files, in your work, because, for example, let's say you're working on some new software that will be patented, so, you know, there's still some intellectual property and other sensitive content. But if your data can be fully anonymized, then it's not personal data, and then just take it anywhere, even to, you know, wherever you wanna put it. But often we are not able to anonymize the data, so we can only, for example, de-identify. So here I wrote kind of think of a fingerprint. I know many of you are working with brain images, and brain images are just, you know, are just like another type of fingerprint. Maybe not as accessible as the fingerprint on our finger, because that's quite easy to collect the type of data. But anyway, it is an identifier of somebody. If I get the brain image of some of you and I can compare it with a database of all the brain images of people in Finland, I'm able to re-identify the person with quite a high percentage. So for these cases, even though, let's say the brain image, even though you're able to remove, I don't know, the name and the surname of the patient in the image or other features, sometimes you can re-identify people from their dental structures or from the face that is collected in the image, but still it stays personal data even though it's de-identified. So for this type of data that is still sensitive, we need kind of better workflows. And another way why we need secure workflows is also because sometimes we actually need the identity. So sometimes we are not able to get rid of these strong identifiers, the name and the surname, the I don't know, the email address or the ways to contact somebody, because for example you're running a longitudinal study, so it means that the subject that you sampled you might need to meet this person again in 1 year or in 1 month or whatever. And some other times you need, let's say that you get some large data from Tilastokeskus, from Statistics Finland. So you might want to link, let's say that you get data for many individuals and their income, how much money they make. And so you would have a unique identifier for each person and the amount of money that they make. And then maybe you want to link this with some health data from, let's say, Kanta, which is a database here in Finland that stores all the diagnoses and other test results and other health information. So basically, you know, you need to make sure that your person in the dataset from the Statistics Finland is, you know, you need to find a way to match it with the, so that you have the same person in the dataset from Kanta. So of course, a way to do this, or a risky way to do this, would be by using the Henkilötunnus, for example, so that you would get the data from Statistics Finland, basically for every row is an individual, and you get the Henkilötunnus and let's say the income, the amount of money that they make. But then you would also get from Kanta, for each Henkilötunnus, you would also get, let's say, the list of diagnoses that these people had in their life. So of course this is a risky data set, because suddenly you have, you know, the Henkilötunnus, which is maybe one of the most sensitive piece of personal data. So there are ways, the so-called pseudonymization. I'm sorry, the pseudonymization is a bit of a term that is used in multiple ways, but in this case, the pseudonymization means exactly replacing the social ID, the social security number, Henkilötunnus, with the generated number, so that it's like a unique, so that from my social security number, you can generate a fake number, and the same fake number is in the registry, in the data that comes from Statistics Finland, as well as in the data that comes from the Kanta database. So these approaches are called hashing, where you basically transform, in this case, the Henkilötunnus, the social security number, into a specific new number, into a new string, and the hash key can be owned by someone else, for example, THL. So that these are quite secure ways of making sure that you can still de-identify somebody, but only few people can kind of, you know, how can I say, decode the hash key, so that you obtain the social security number. So now, to be practical, is anyone here working with this type of data where you have social security number from many individuals and you need to link it with multiple sources? You can raise your hand or write on HackMD. looks like that no one is raising their hand, so this is a bit of a, so I'm not saying that it's an extreme case, some people are working with this type of data, but you understand that this type of workflow maybe it's not really needed often. If I think of studies that are run in my department, for example, there might be some 30 or some 50 or 100 subjects, and then it's enough to basically invent your own mapping and just call the first subject number one and the second subject number two. So no complicated pseudonymization based on hashing, because most likely you don't need to go back to those individuals. But of course, then you don't need DHL to keep the key of the mapping. But then you need to make sure that you have a system for example, for storing. If you need to keep these keys, you might wanna store them on a paper, in a paper document, maybe in some locked place at Alto. Okay, so there was actually a question on the HackMD before I continue with the workflows. If images from other body parts are also like fingerprints other than brain images, I would say that anything that is measured from a human body is a good fingerprint. Some things might be a little bit more difficult. I'm actually trying to compile a list of different kind of data that you can collect from a human body and what is the kind of the probability of being re-identified. So far I found that the list will be published under Alto, so don't worry. But so far I found that, for example, speech has quite a strong re-identification, even with background noise, even with background music. So more than 80% you can be certain that you can re-identify somebody. And for body parts in general, anything, whether it's a CT or MRI or X-ray, it's quite easy. How can I say? If let's say that I take an X-ray of my hand and I have a database of other X-rays of my hands, the way how the bone grow and the specific proportions between all the bones, they become a fingerprint in the sense that they are quite unique. There are, of course, so what we know from this type of large studies, that there is a chance, or how can I say, that the chance of re-identifying somebody gets a little bit lower if you have a twin or if you have a relative. So for example, with the brain images, with the foldings of the brain, people who are related tend to have a little bit more similar brain foldings. And the same goes with the DNA, as you know. But in general, I would assume, or if you want to play it safe, we can basically say that anything that is measured from the body is a fingerprint. That unless you process it so heavily that that you're kind of destroying what is personal. Like imagine that, out of the whole picture from the head, you only store two numbers. Let's say the head's volume and the circumference of the head. So with those two numbers only, it's impossible to re-identify somebody. Oh well, even there, one could have such a unique, specific, it's like re-identifying somebody from the age. It's basically impossible unless there is that single individual who is the oldest in the country and everyone know about them. All right, so still talking about workflows. So there are different type of level of security in the workflow, and we touched about the I talked about the storage, I talked about the computing, and I talked also about the code. So here I listed some type of options in different domains. So Fin data, I don't know how many of you have heard about Fin data. You can raise your virtual hand on Zoom. If you, where is the virtual? I don't see it anymore. Okay, somebody found it. So at least one person is there about film data. So maybe then I ask the question the other way. Does anyone want to learn about film data, or we just move on? So if you want to learn, if you want me to tell me a little bit something about film data, I can say. Otherwise, okay, since there is tense. So film data is like an organization related to the government, where the idea of film data is that it helps scientists and research institutions to get access to sensitive data, to personal data, for the so-called secondary use of data. So imagine that, like the example that I said earlier, the Kanta database. So in the Kanta database, for each of us, if your data is inside Kanta, there are stored all the diagnoses and some laboratory tests and other type of health data. So this data was connected for the purpose of, you know, helping us with our health. But then one could ask for this type of data for a secondary purpose, which would basically mean research in our case. So film data would kind of take into account these requests. Let's say they have an hypothesis that you need to, that you want to study all the people in Finland because you have a specific hypothesis on some correlation between their health data and, like as I was saying earlier, their economic income. So you apply for the data from film data. The issue with film data is that they have a very strict request or requirement, sorry, on how the data should be processed and how the data should be stored. So long story short, all the systems that we have right now at Aalto are not good for film data. So film data, we wouldn't be able right now to store data coming from film data, and we wouldn't be able right now to analyze data that comes from film data. But we are working on it. So the idea that film data, actually, that I'm saying here coming soon, because from the 1st of May, film data, the so-called film data compatible IT system, should be implemented in those organizations that need to process this type of data. Although they are extending the deadline because maybe they realize that 1st of May comes too soon. But in general, the requirements is that there should be audit of everything. With audit of everything means that the system logs all the access to each file on who accessed what and when, which means lots and lots amount of auditing. And the reason, of course, is for security purposes, that if something bad happens, one could go back to the logs and re-identify, okay, who, I don't know, copied the data out from the system, for example. So this similar type of requirement of the audit of everything is also comes from other organizations that provide this type of data, like DHL. But of course, there are exceptions. So if you work with this type of data from film data for DHL, Aalto is actually piloting now this type of film data compatible system. So you can get in contact with me and we can set you up for the pilot. Then, in general at Aalto, there are the share folder that I mentioned already earlier. And in here are slides, you can look at all the various options. I think for those of you who are familiar with the work that we do at Aalto Scientific Computing, here we also explain a lot about which data should be stored where, because there's so many different types of locations where you can store your data. But in general, if you know that you're using one of these Aalto folders that are on the cloud, they might not yet be thin data, you know, certified, but they're still secure enough, because you know that a group folder is visible only by the member of your groups, and you can control the, you can be sure that only those people can access the data. Then when it comes to the sensitivity of the code, well, basically you don't want to store on GitHub something that is sensitive. Let's say that you have a script that removes some identifiers from your original data, and you might have coded in the script some names and some surnames or whatever you might have coded there, well, maybe you don't want to keep that on GitHub. So, and in general, you know, there are other options, but what is nice about GitHub, or sorry, what is nice about the Git system is that you don't actually need GitHub for storing the actual code. So if you have access to an SSH server, like we do at Alto with this Kosh, Talta, and others, so you can actually not use GitHub at all, or GitLab or whatever web-based system, and just store kind of, you know, have the repository of your code basically into one of Alto servers. Then there is a nice tool for secure kind of computing analysis of your data, which is called VDI. Again, if you can raise your hand, how many here have never heard about VDI? I see one raised hand. Okay, some people have not heard about VDI. VDI, in my opinion, is extremely useful, and not just for, you know, well, I'm gonna give you a demo of VDI. I have it actually open in another window right now, but I'll show you how it would work. So if you go to, and you can test this while I'm doing it if you want, if you go to vdi.alto.fi, and basically you can click on this, there are two options, whether you install this virtual machine VMware client, but you can also use it within the browser window. So now I'm going to access it within the browser window. I type my name, my Alto login. And then it lets you choose between few options. If you want to have basically an Alto Linux workstation or an Alto Windows workstation, there are some options with this graphic cards, but there's not too many of them, so they tend to be busy. But what is handy here, now I'm going to click on this, it's basically like logging in this. I already had a session open, so I was running things, but basically the idea is that we log in into the same workstation that you would see if you're logging in your office. In this case it's a Linux, Alto Linux. In the Windows case it would just look the same. And what it's interesting here is now that the computing actually is not happening in your local machine. So now I'm with a laptop, and with the laptop is connected through the web on this vdi.alto.fi, but all the computation and everything that I want to run actually is inside the Alto Cloud. On the web page there, I added this link here. And in my opinion, this is an important picture to understand for anyone, not just for anyone who wants to do, you know, coding or something difficult, but even for those, you know, even if your data is, how can I say, anything that is sensitive data, I'm not talking now with the Linux experts or the Python experts, anyone who knows that they have sensitive data and their data should basically stay within the Alto network. They have all these options that, for example, connect to the VPN and make sure that the storage that you access, whether it's from this Alto or the Triton cluster, we don't need to talk about Triton, but basically the storage is within the Alto VPN. VDI is just, you know, through the web browser, it's just an interface that you can get some computational power within the Alto network. So, for example, there was a case a few days ago at MBE, a professor has some videos of their participants, but now he's traveling and he's not in Europe anymore. So in the kind of the old way of looking at these videos, you would need to download the videos outside the Alto network, store them in wherever computer in whatever country, nobody knows where. And so, you know, potentially this is a security breach when it comes to, you know, for this GDPR, if these are videos, you know, where you see the faces and the names and other stuff. But then the option is that this professor can actually go to vdi.alto.fi and look at the video from the web browser. So the videos will stay in the Alto network. The person is still able to look at the video, annotate the video, and when it's done with the work, you can just close the web browser, the connection is dropped, and nothing is kind of transferred, you know, locally into whatever machine. So I hope that this picture, this is an important picture that is useful for those who do more computational light work, but also for those who are doing heavy computational work. I check if there's any questions in the HackMD. I remind you that this is the link and you can always ask anything that comes to your mind. And then for more complicated cases, kind of the thin data approach, where you would need that. So if we go back to the picture here, you know, here these computing servers are quite secure, but on the same box, on the same computer, let's say on the same VDI machine, there might be other users running the analysis. So there is the theoretical risk that some malicious user might start, you know, trying to access content of the memory that other users are working on. So, you know, it's you know, we are going towards the highly improbable, highly impossible scenarios, but still, if you think of thin data workflow, really sensitive data, you basically want to get a node, a computing node, a computing machine that is dedicated just for you and just for your process, and there is absolutely no way that anybody else can run anything at the same time on that machine. So at Alto, we don't have such computing nodes, but a solution in Finland is to use the EPOT system from CSC. And the good news for those of you who might need this kind of secure computing workflow is that we are now attaching an instance of IPOTA to the Alto system. So from the picture here, you have to imagine that there will be CSC cloud here with the IPOTA system, so that you can actually access a dedicated node where then you know that it's only you there opening the data and doing something with the sensitive data. All right, I think we are basically done with the most generic part. I'm for this first, before we go to medical image, I also wanted to mention about differential privacy, because some, at least two of you were asking. I don't know if those two people are around today. But the idea of differential privacy, let me check if I have a picture from Wikipedia. Maybe I didn't include it. But the idea is also very similar to what Dan was talking about last week when he was talking about spatial data. So in the example that Dan gave, they were the locations of the desks at Alto, so spatial locations, longitude and latitude. And of course, given the exact location, you could re-identify where, you know, that desk corresponds to that specific person. So one way is to kind of perturbate the data, so add a little bit of noise so that you don't exactly know where the exact position of the desk gets kind of randomly moved, displaced a little bit. So the same thing, you could think it can be applied for other data. So that, imagine that you have age and height. So they have a data set where you collect the age and height of people. Not that sensitive data set, because age and height are, you know, it would be quite challenging to re-identify somebody just with age and height, unless it's the tallest person in Finland who is some sort of celebrity. But anyway, the idea would be that then to kind of differentially anonymize your data set, you would map the actual value of age and height into a value that are very close, but not exactly like they used to be originally. So that, you know, each age number, basically what would mean, let's say that if the original age is 30, some subject were 30, they might be mapped to 31, and some others might be mapped to 29. The idea is that the kind of general structure within the data, if there is a correlation between age and height, it's still somewhat preserved, but then at the same time you are kind of aware that you don't have the exactly original data anymore, that you're working with some sort of anonymized data. And this brings me to a more interesting topic, which is data synthesis. In my opinion, it's the early day of data synthesis, but this will be a very interesting topic and very interesting way of working with the personal data. So there is one package actually developed at Aalto called Twinify. They have a nice visualization here. So basically, well, this is what I just told you about differential private data. But the idea is this, you know, that imagine that you have that each dot that you see in this picture A is an individual. Let's say that in your data set, you collected the age of each individual. And so, you know, now for each dot, some people or many people have some certain age, only one person has this age and only one person has that age. You can basically estimate the distribution, the statistical distribution of your individuals. And then, given the statistical distribution, you kind of synthesize fake individuals from the same statistical distribution. So this is called probabilistic modeling. The idea, of course, here is quite trivial with one variable, but imagine that you have multiple variables. So in micro data, tabular data that has many columns, you can basically find the so-called joint distribution of all these variables and try to synthesize some fake data so that it matches the you know, this, it has the same properties of the original data that you had, but now it's fully synthesized data. There is no way that you can go back and re-identify somebody. Of course, there are some papers, or you know, nothing is ever fully soundproof. If you have an extreme case, that will still might be re-identifiable even in the synthesis. But once again, if something is extremely rare, then you wouldn't want to treat that kind of, or you should kind of accept that it's impossible to anonymize or de-identify cases that are extremely rare, like extremely rare diseases or somebody who is the oldest person in Finland and things like that. So I don't know if now to do something practical before the break, I don't know if you wanna test this Twinify. I have some data if you want to give it a go, but on the other hand, I'm not sure how many here are Python users. I know many of you are non-Python users. Unfortunately, with this type of synthesis methods, there is, at least as far as I know, there are no graphical tools that one could use in a more, basically without coding. And even these tools actually always require some debugging. So specifically, for example, if you want to install this Twinify and test it yourself, you actually need to add this. I already told to the developers that they have a dependency that is not listed in their package, so that you know, so that basically you get an idea. But maybe I'm not sure if this type of exercise is interesting or not. Let's see if anyone is writing anything or how can be. Because the other option, of course, is that I can, that we don't need to test this Twinify if nobody wants to test it. And I can wrap up this first part and then we spend a little bit more time for the medical images. I'm not able to read this. Yeah, that's of course, this is also why the VDI workflow is useful, because for example, when I test things, I test them on the VDI, because then I know if I was able, this is actually why here in my VDI I have in some window here the Twinify that I tested, because then on the VDI system, you know, there is disk space. You, if the power of VDI is not enough, you can actually get more power from Triton, from our computing cluster. So we're not limited to our laptop, but yeah, I totally know the feeling. My laptop is also slow and old. All right, but maybe then let's continue to the with the, so that we can wrap up this generic part and keep the rest of the day for the medical images. So maybe some consideration about this differential privacy. So I'm sure you've heard about the term precision medicine. Do you know what I mean when I say precision medicine? Maybe, maybe not. I can. All right, well, the idea with precision medicine is that given, I'm not saying lots of data, but given enough data from an individual, you can kind of target the best diagnosis and the most, I mean, you could kind of produce the most accurate diagnosis and target the best cure for a specific individual. So the issue with differential privacy and synthesis in general is that we are actually destroying the strong individuality. We still preserve some sort of, you know, generic individuality. So like with Twinify, you know, we can still synthesize a population that is very similar to the original population of the study. But then if you need to go back to the individual, you can't anymore. You might be able to build a model, a machine learning model, a diagnosis model from the fake data. But in the end, you need to still give the diagnosis to a single individual. So differential, in my opinion at least, and some experts' opinion, differential privacy is a good tool if your goal is to develop or, for example, study this strong correlations or whatever patterns in the data. But if your goal would be to, let's say, create a diagnostic tool for an individual, then it's the, you know, do you really want to destroy the original data and maybe, in, you know, not get a good diagnosis for the individual, or should you maybe work with the original, as original as possible data, so that you can, you know, give the actual best diagnosis or best cure? Then another open challenge that in my opinion will see lots of work in the future is how do we synthesize fake images. So it's a very challenging topic, and I would say that this field is so new that only since 2019 we have seen paper in this topic. I'm now clicking on this link here just to give you an idea on how powerful these tools are. They're based on these deep learning techniques, or so-called generative adversarial networks. So kind of deep, like machine, or how do you call them? Like artificial networks, so that you can basically synthesize fake pictures. You might have seen those people. It's actually from Aalto, from Professor Jaakko Lehtinen, that some people were able to generate very realistic looking faces. So the algorithm, the kind of mathematics, the code behind is similar. But now instead of generating, you know, faces, fake faces, we might want to generate fake MRIs. But what is interesting is that it's not just generating, like I was saying earlier, fake MRI for some generic population study, but you can actually generate an MRI from someone else. So imagine that from an individual, you collect this type of, like from an individual, there are many types of images that you can collect, medical images. So one is the PET, positron emission tomography, which is a very low resolution image. But another one is the so-called what is the CT, like a computational tomography, something like that, so that it's a little bit more high resolution image in this case of the brain, of the head of the individual. So with this synthesis technique, computed tomography, thank you. So with this technique, you can actually transform, like you can actually start from the PET low quality image and synthesize what would be the CT scan. So this is quite amazing because in some countries, in some hospitals, they might not have, let's say, the PET scanner, or they might not have the CT scanner. But then with just one type of image, you're actually able to synthesize what you would have gotten from the other scanner, or at least, you know, close enough with what you would have gotten. So this type of technique is also very useful if you know that there are artifacts in the data you collected. So in this case, the patient was moving, the head was moving during the magnetic resonance imaging collection, but then you can basically resynthesize the pixels, the voxels of this image, so that it looks like a clear picture. So all these techniques, they're based on this series of nested artificial neural networks. I'm not going to go into the details, but it's basically work. Some of this work has also been done by people at Aalto. This is, for example, what you would get with pictures, so that in this case you remove the rain, you know, with this type of synthesis technique. So definitely, you know, synthesis, you will hear about synthesis when it comes to personal data. And then I listed some papers of this type of applications in medical field, but of course, you know, I can expect that this type of synthesis can also be applied, or well, it's already applied for videos with faces. I'm sure you have heard about the so-called deepfakes technology, where you can actually replace a moving face from a video with someone else's, so that then it would look like that, I don't know, that Trump or Obama is talking, even though it's you. And then another advanced approach, we still have 5 minutes before the break, it is a so-called federated analysis approach. So I show the picture from Wikipedia. And basically the idea is that now the computation, because the data is so sensitive, let's say that the data is in different hospitals, or it's in some different, I don't know, universities, and they don't allow that this personal data leaves the university or leaves the hospital. So what you can do actually is that instead of getting the data from these multiple sources and run the computation in your university on your own computer, you actually give the code to all these multiple hospitals, to all these multiple organizations. So here, in this case, you know, there would be a central place. That, you know, let's imagine that this is your workstation where you build the model, the software, and then there are multiple nodes that actually have the data that you are not able to access. So what you can do is that basically you deliver the software to each hospital in this case, or each university, and then within each network, everyone runs the model or runs the software and fits the new model. So then you get, you know, some new models, and then you update your kind of summary model. I don't see it because I have to zoom in this. And then you update your summary model based on what you got from multiple hospitals or multiple universities. So this is a very interesting technique because the computing and the data storage stays in the, you know, where it's supposed to stay, in the hospital or in the university that doesn't allow the data transfer, but you're still able to run your analysis using multiple data sets and basically combine the final result. So the challenge, of course, with the federated analysis is that there is a technical and a human bottleneck. So, you know, there is the technical bottleneck that imagine that you need to bring your code to multiple hospitals. It might be challenging Because you basically need to package, you know, you might not be able to go inside each hospital and set up your Python environment or whatever computational environment. So there are solutions for this, and they're called containers. So containers can be very helpful in this type of analysis of sensitive data where you are not able to access the data, but you can at least deliver like a container with all the software installed and tools that are needed so that someone else in the hospital or in the organization can run it and produce the numbers that would basically are useful for your study. But then there is also the human bottleneck, because even if you are so good in making a container of your analysis and deliver it to the hospital, I don't think, you know, you might not be able to actually go to the hospital and teach anyone how to run the container, and the hospital themselves, they might not have the technology, the human power for somebody, you know, to run the container or even to check your code that you didn't include any security issue or things like that. So once again, basically something to keep in mind for the future, the synthesis of personal data in this federated analysis, there will be more and more of them coming. Okay, so let me check the clock. I think we are perfectly in time. We have 2 minutes and then we can have a break. So as I wrote, you can add questions here, of course, and comments. But basically, I would like to spend the rest of today with those of you who are more working with the medical images and medical data, brain images. So it's totally fine if you want to leave. But before leaving, if you're here for the credit, maybe you want to send me a message with the Zoom chat that so that I can mark your presence. And then for those who are interested in the credit, I will contact you individually so that you will do a fair task, you know, nothing too demanding. I'm not really counting the single hours. Is it 27 hours for one credit? It's, you know, something that is useful for you. You don't need to prove anything to me. So the idea is that you can find some time useful for yourself to solve your problem, and that can be your homework, basically. Okay, so if you have a question, leave it here in the HackMD, and then we come back in 15 minutes and we cover medical images and DICOM files and that stuff. Hello. Sorry, my screen sharing went. All right. So basically, yeah, I guess now the people who are left here are people who are working with health data and medical imaging and things like that. So maybe I wouldn't mind knowing for the people here, what do you actually work with? So if you could go to the HackMD, I repaste the link in the chat for your convenience. There's, how many are we now? So if I don't count myself, we have 7. So I'm expecting 7 answers. If you are not working with health data or medical data or this type of stuff and you're just here for your curiosity, please write it down anyway so that At least we know. Oh, I think I forgot to upload that. Let me check. I forgot to upload the DICOM files. One second, then I move them to some Google Drive. Unless you are on, you have a Triton account. If you can also specify if you have a Triton account, because the files are on Triton. But if some of you doesn't have a Triton account, then I should put those files to Google Drive. I'm now anyway making a folder in Google Drive. So it looks like everyone has a Triton account. Am I right? So I see 5 answers. So I need 2 more to know that we reach 7. If you are not working with medical images, you can add the answer that no, I don't work with medical images. Or maybe then these 2 persons are not here right now. And, well, at least we can make it. Okay, let me move stuff to it. Yeah, maybe I move the files to Google Drive anyway. It's a nice data set that you are free to reuse. So there's just 5 of you, and I'm just gonna give it to you. It's but the data in a way it's already out there. Let me start the upload from this other computer and then second. All right, it should be fast enough because I'm not an alien. But in the meantime, I tell you some things. So let's see people with fMRI, at least 2 fMRI. So MRI, basically, with an F. Then some wedges in X-ray and CT images in DICOM. And in practice, even the MRI people, at least the way you know they are collected is DICOM format. Although often with MRI or with fMRI, we convert them to nifty. And then I see some MEG and EEG, which are almost the same, and ECG, so kind of heart time series. All right. So, well, basically, well, then it's also useful to ask you how many of you have applied any de-identification or have used any identification tool. So, for example, the person who is using X-ray and CT images, who's working with DICOM, are you already using a DICOM de-identifier, anonymizer, and what DICOM tool do you use to browse the images so you can expand? And then those working with MRI, have you run some de-identification of MRI images? And if so, which tool have you used? And then EEG and MEG is tricky because if, at least in my years of using MEG and EEG, I never came across EEG or MEG data that contain some sensitive stuff, but of course in the header of those files, there might be. And so maybe a question for those who are working with MEG and EEG, are you collecting the data here at Aalto, where we don't store anything, or do you get data from the hospital or from external databases so that we get an idea? So somebody not done any identification. The DICOM person already gets images already de-identified. MEG and fMRI, not any identification. This somebody's going to collect data at Tampere. And then, yeah, okay. Well, it's good that somebody's also mentioned fMRI prep, because I might talk also a bit about BIDS, which is a way to de-identify DICOM images. Maybe the person who collects DICOM files, are you collecting X-ray and CT images of the head, or do you, like, which part of the body? The DICOM person, if you can write down which part of the body do you collect or get data? Okay, Scott. All right, yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, I got the picture clear. The upload is going and it's 125%. All right, maybe before then I give you the data, I can show you actually where the data will be and make it shareable with you. Wait a second, because I'm on two computers. All right, do it from here. Well, the data is loading. Anyway, so, okay, medical images, which and medical data. So already from what you're saying, it's clear that some of you, if not all of you, are working with DICOM images, which is the de facto standard of medical images, and it's used in any sort of images. So now I'm gonna show you, and I need to reshare my screen because I'm only sharing. Yeah, so for example, now I'm gonna show this data set that is actually on Triton. So this data set that I'm gonna show you now It's from a paper that I'm reviewing, and it comes, the original source of the dataset is from the Cancer Imaging Archive. The data is already public, so you could already access it. And in general, the Cancer Imaging Archive is an amazing resource when it comes to DICOM images and any other images that you might need for your studies. So if I look at the browser, so in this study that I'm reviewing, that is now under peer review, but the data is already available there. So I'm sharing the data with you, but theoretically, you should basically register to the Cancer Imaging Archive. In practice, you don't need to prove anything. They just check that you are affiliated to an institution, meaning that your email address is, you know, in some institution. But they have released a nice DICOM data set, which is about de-identify or pseudo de-identify. So they created some 21 subjects that are, how can I say? Let me create things. They have synthesized 21 subjects. So, well, the images are real, they're not synthetic. And then for these subjects, they basically invented their names and their surname and any other sensitive data that might be stored in the so-called header of the DICOM file, as well as the actual image. And then they also provide the kind of state-of-the-art de-identify data for each subject. So it's a nice small data set for this type of courses, but also for this type of tests for learning what type of, you know, personal data you might see in the DICOM headers or in the DICOM images themselves. So now I was a bit critical when I was reviewing this paper, because they didn't produce, like, they are producing the data, but they were not very clear on how they de-identify the data. It's always a mystery how people do things. So apparently they have a tool that they are going to release, which is, you know, state-of-the-art de-identification of the DICOM files. But of course, here today, I can show you at least what other options are out there. In general, I can tell you that there's so many options for opening DICOM files and browsing DICOM files and de-identify DICOM files, that it's hard to tell you, you know, go and use this. But long story short, if you're a Python user, pick a Python option. If you're a graphic interface user, pick a graphic interface tool, etc., etc. So I try to list here many options for browsing and having a look at these graphical tools. But I will spend a little bit of time on this so-called command line interface tools, which in my opinion, I find them extremely handy. So most likely all of you are Triton users or familiar with the command line. But in general, if you browse through the folders and you have many folders with the DICOM files, then having a command line tool makes the life easier. And then of course, you can also use Python or MATLAB or other tools for loading DICOM files. So, and the tool that then I was thinking of testing with you is this PyCOM DEID. But now I'm just wondering, because in practice, from what you wrote in the HackMD, there is basically just one person that is using DICOM formats. Of course, I don't have anything against this person. I still like you, but I'm just wondering for the for the usefulness of everyone if we should spend some 20 minutes in this, trying to use this tool, or if this is a good exercise that this person can do. But I will anyway explain what's in this website. But for sure, I think that everyone, all of us, should spend some minutes with these command line tools. Okay, so this data set from the Cancer Imaging Archive, it should be now in Google Drive, or it's 50% in Google Drive. And then there's another data set that you can already start downloading, which is on Zenodo. And so it's here that I'm highlighting it. For your convenience, I also paste it on the chat. And these are also DICOM files. So given what you wrote in the chat, I'm going to rearrange now things like this, because most of you are using MRIs, which basically you start from DICOM. So the first thing that we can do is that we at least test these command line tools for basically getting all the properties from a DICOM image. And then I would like you to pick one tool to visualize DICOM files. It might take some time to install it. So, you know, I'm not saying that you must do it right now. Unfortunately, at Aalto, there are some tools installed, but I'm not happy with any of them. So I think that it goes down to the user. So many are recommending this DICOM browser, which I'm opening now. It's a nice tool. It's part of this XNAT kind of package of data management for well, brain images, but of course it can be any sort of DICOM. And I think I have it installed in this computer. I can show you how it looks like. But I found it that it's not very, very intuitive. So let me check if I have some image. So now this, I downloaded this image from, there's another link that I pasted on the chat. And there are these files inside. So this is the images of the head of an individual. And just in case you don't know, every folder contains like a run, and each of these files is called slice. Of course, DICOM has multiple ways of storing the images. Sometimes they're stored as slices, sometimes they're stored at volume, but in this specific case, they're slices. And the first one that you see often if you collect MRI data, or if you get full access to the MRI data, is the so-called localizer, which is basically just a couple of slices to get the position of the head inside the scanner. And then here they collected two slices. Now I don't remember by heart what they did here, but we have the Zenodo link. Where was it? This, so I think it was a T1, so-called T1 weighted image. Yeah, and a T2 weighted. All right, so I think the T1, from what I remember, is in the second. It's in the second. So as I said, there are many tools for using browsing DICOM files. DICOM browser is recommended, but I'm not very happy with it. I've included for you this link so that you can give it a try to, you know, what you like. Some tools are actually paid. I like this tool that is often used by doctors that works really nicely, but it's not free. But what I do is that I, maybe this should be off the record, but I uninstall it and reinstall it, and then it works again. So it's a Radiant DICOM viewer. I like it because I have many options here So now I selected a folder and I said open with Radiant. And here, that is the person, the DICOMs of this person. And yeah, so now maybe for this first exercise is that if you can install, well, first download this, maybe I'll write it down so that it's a little bit more clear. And sorry that I'm jumping up and down, but I'm adapting the content of the lecture to your, to what basically what you wrote. Okay. Download the Zenodo DICOM. Okay. Yeah, maybe the download dies. I had problems myself with Zenodo recently. I'm gonna put it now in this Google Drive where this other DICOM dataset is uploaded. So let's download the Zenodo DICOM files and then pick a tool. If you are, pick a graphical tool, sorry. Oops. If you are unsure, why is this jumping up and down? If you are unsure, this DICOM browser. And then basically try to open an image. Now, while you're downloading, I can show you how it looks with DICOM browser. So this is an unfortunate hack that is related to Alto Windows, and now they are installing things. But basically, to like, if I would open DICOM browser from here with the Alto Windows and try to search for the image, because this all the disks of the Alto Windows are not physically attached, it has troubles. This issue is actually present also with the most recent MATLAB and other tools. But if you drag and drop, now these are the unzip from the Zenodo file. So if I drag and drop, let's say this is the T1 folder to this DICOM browser. So now we should start DICOM browser with the images. And now this, I see DICOM browser here. These are some of the personal data that you store in the DICOM header. And here all the images. Then if you double click, if my computer wakes up, when you double click an image, you basically can see the image. You can annotate and do other things. But I don't find it, like, I'm happy to hear what, if you have a favorite tool, if you will find a favorite tool to open DICOM files. DICOM browser is very useful because now I see all the so-called metadata. So everything that is in the header of this file. So, you know, the manufacturer of the scanner, the name of the physician. So this data was not de-identified. Now maybe this, whatever, Mrs. Mr. Whittingham is an actual person that collected this MRI data. In this case, it's the subject themselves that released this data, so they did not care about de-identifying their own images. So I think that, let me find the tag for the name. There's the patient address, patient weight, patient birth date. So you see, this is all personal data that, you know, you wouldn't like to have. Okay, here's the name, patient's name, Lionheart William. So in this case, the person wanted to release, it's their data, they have the rights to release it. Although, to be precise, they should have removed the name of the physician who collected the image. But basically, you see, you know, how useful it is to look to quality control your data and make sure that you don't have, you know, the name. I've seen it so many times I've been working with some hospital with DICOM files coming from hospital, and they don't do any de-identification. They just send you the images and you have everything there, even this ankyloturnus, this social security number. So it's important that you have a tool to check these tags. Now DICOM Rise is a graphical tool. I hope you can get it running. And but now after this, I'll show you. I prefer using the command line, because with the command line tool you can quickly, you know, run it for many folders and, for example, look if the patient's name is left in the tags, or if it needs to be removed. Maybe one thing here, let me go back to the HackMD. So for those of you using getting DICOM files, meaning MRI, fMRI and X-ray and CT, do you collect the data yourself, or do you get it from hospital or someone else? I'm specifically thinking of people at Alto. We use our MRI scanner. We do not store any whatever personal data in the header of these DICOM files. So if you collect data at AMI Center, basically you're fine. You don't need to check that the name and the surname of the patient is there. But if you get images from the hospital, so for example, this person who is using X-ray and CT images, maybe you get them from the hospital. So there might be, you know, this is something useful that you need to first check that they didn't send you DICOM files with the name and surnames and ankyloturnus in the headers. And then you need to actually, you know, strip out these identifiers. Okay, so okay, the other data set is now finished to download. So while you try to install and test some graphical tools, I upload quickly the file from Zenodo to our share folder, and then I will share the, let's close the windows. This is the kind of part of the workshop that it would be nice to be in the same room and doing together, but you know, maybe one day. So, all right. So now try to get the visual DICOM program so that you can open this image from Zenodo. In the meantime, I need to upload that. I need to stop sharing for a sec. I need to stop sharing because I'm browsing folders that might have sensitive data. So our Triton administrators folders. Okay, so let me add also this Zenodo file. Okay, so now there's another data is uploading, and now I can share this Google Drive folder with you. So please remember that I'm sharing this data from the Cancer Image Archive, it's fake data. So, you know, it's there are no, well, let me explain. It's the metadata is fake. There are no real name or surnames or real people, but the actual images are real. The data is openly available if you register to the Cancer Image Archive. I'm not asking you to register to the Cancer Image Archive, but just remember that if you are going to use this data, if you are going to keep a copy of this data to your on your computer, you know, register to the Cancer Image Archive so that you are good with the law. How can I get the link? I'm waiting that well, I can share the screen with you actually now. I'm waiting that Google Drive responds. Okay. So now I paste the link on chat, so that it's not written anywhere, so only the people here have actual access to this link. Check if you can access it. And so this is a very useful data set, especially for that single person who is going to work with X-ray and CT images, because this, you know, if you want to learn, like, I'm sorry that now we don't spend the rest hour to actually basically use this tool that I will quickly talk, but for you, in my opinion, it's very important. Well, actually not that important, because you wrote that you get already the identify images. So maybe for you, it's more important to make sure that these images are already de-identified. But in general, if you have free time, you know, maybe this would be a good homework for you, is to use this data set that I share with you and actually test this tool that I've listed here. Are you a Python user, by the way? This X-ray CT person. You can also use the microphone if you. Yes. Excellent. So then there is this tool, this DEID. So again, I was planning, if there would be more of you using DICOM, this is a good exercise that we could have done together. It's a Python package for anonymization and the identification of DICOM images, any types of DICOM images, and they are very good examples. It's not, you know, how can I say? It's not something that you just run a one-liner and everything is done. It's a little bit, it requires a little bit of understanding of how it works, but the people who made it, they wrote this example page. And if you follow at least this person, if you follow from the introduction to all the parts here, you really, you know, you can really master the full de-identification of DICOM files. So this takes care of both the kind of data that you might have in the header, what we saw here with the DICOM browser, so like the patient name and this type of stuff, but also data that can be in the actual picture. So now from this data set of this Cancer Imaging Archive, so now inside that folder, let me open it. So you see it. So inside that folder there, it's also on Triton. This is what I meant, but it's also on Triton shared data in set one and the DOI of that paper, of that data set. So I now briefly explain on these two folders. So one folder contains the pseudo identify or de-identify DICOM files for these 21 subjects, and instead the other folder contains the kind of pseudo original data. So now this is a good, again, it would take too long time to go through each subject, but if you are interested in learning more about DICOM and this type of stuff, you can actually tell it to me in a private message, because this is a good exercise for your homework if you want to get the credit, of course. But basically, once you find an image, or sorry, a folder with images, then you can have a look with your favorite tool. And then in this case, you know, you see that there is actual text in the picture. So in this case, you know, you need to evaluate, is it text? Like sometimes in these x-rays or other images, you might have the name of the patient. And so, you know, that is not just about removing this metadata from the header, but you also need to edit the pixels. In this case here, okay, the first image had some metadata, but I don't see anything. Or sorry, some pixels, but I don't see any sensitive. I think there was one subject that had x-ray. No, I don't remember them by heart. Let's just pick another one. So yeah, this is an x-ray. So for example, here in this case, in the actual image, you see some device and some other tag. If this would be a number, you know, so you might have the tag of the patient. So then you need to, you know, put a blur this part of the image. So the DICOM de-identification is not just about removing this, you know, name and surname, like here you see James Michael, but also getting rid of this of actual pixels. Now instead it looks like that the other people in the room are mostly working with brain images. So then when it comes to brain and head, it's the case of this DICOM file that you now should also have if you have troubles in downloading it in the same Google Drive that I share with you. And now let me open that. Yeah, here it is. So here in this case, what we want to do from this DICOM file is not just, of course, remove, get rid of this, header, this metadata, this name and surname fields, but also we want to get rid of the face. So the reason of getting rid of the face kind of comes from the American law, which is the, sorry, my dyslexic. So in the United States, why can't I get a list of these identifiers? All right, I have to. But basically, you know, in the United States, they don't have the equivalent, or the equivalent of the GDPR that they have in the United States is more relaxed than the actual GDPR. In the GDPR, everything is personal data. Even if you removed any sort of tag from the DICOM file, but because the brain in this case is personal, you know, is a fingerprint, then it would still be personal data. In the United States, they are happy to get rid of this direct identifier, name and birth date and whatever, and the face. So if you get rid of the face and this direct identifier, then it's not personal data anymore. And this is why for the brain people here, you have repositories like OpenNeuro, where you can, you know, go there and you don't even need to log in, you don't even need to apply for any ethics permit or whatever. You can start downloading brain images, EEG, MEG, fMRI, and whatever. But of course, all the data, all this MRI data, especially this high quality, so-called anatomical MRI data for the face, it is defaced. So you wrote in HackMD that nobody has done any de-identification, so I believe that none of you has run any defacing, am I right? But do you know what I mean when I talk when I say defacing? If you can give me a signal. Is it clear, this defacing? Yeah. So that basically what we could test. Well, now it's time for the little break, but what we could test after the break is that we could actually deface this image from the Zenodo. So after the break, we use one technique for anonymizing DICOM files, which is converting them to Nifty. And I will tell a little bit more about Nifty, although looking at the people and what you wrote, most likely you all know what is the Nifty file format. And then I will mention about the BIDS standard, which kind of can preserve the information from the DICOM to the Nifty. So then we will run together. This is an exercise that we will do together because most of the people here are working with MRIs of the brain. And so we will run together with a command line this DCN to NIFTY. And we also, I'll show you also how to install it. And then after doing that, we can run a so-called defacing algorithm. So is it okay if we have a little bit shorter break, that we come back at 10 past 14? I just want to make sure that we have enough time to play with these things. Or am I asking for too much? There's just 7 of us, so it's 7 of you, 8 of us. All right, but so let's have a break, and then after the break, maybe, okay, no, let's have a break and let's be back at 14:12. Okay, so you're still here. That's good. It's our last mile. Maybe one thing that some of you were writing to me in private, if you're here for the credit, this type of exercises that we are skipping or that we are just going quickly right now, it's a good homework for the credit. So you can send me a private message and tell me, for example, let's say that your case is this X-ray and CT images. So then, I can give you a homework related to that. So that it's something, that you get something useful out of the homework. You don't need to do a homework just to make me happy. All right, but so now, so we looked at these graphical tools. That is DICOM browser, but there's millions of them. Pick one, and if you find a better one, let me know. Let everybody know, because it's good to learn from others, from each other. Then I mentioned about this Python package, which we will not demonstrate right now because there was basically only one of you. But then it's anyway useful to have a look at the command line tools for looking at, for example, to make sure that the MRIs that in DICOM format or whatever DICOM file that you get, they do not contain any sensitive data in the header. So now I'm now going to start doing the steps, and I recommend you to do the same. We could do it like this, that now I'm going to open a new. I can actually do it from a terminal. So now I'm gonna open a terminal to Putty because I'm on a Windows machine. And now I don't know if you are all from MBE or if you're all Alto employees. Maybe some of you are not even from Alto. But anyway, if you can get access to a Linux machine and a terminal, then that's all you need for running this tool. If you are a student, you can connect to kosh.org.alto.fi. If you are employee, you can connect to talta.org.alto.fi. If you are affiliated with MBE, you can also use amor.org. But then I do not recommend Amor. But anyway, at least as far as I understood, you are all from Alto here. Or was there somebody actually from Tampere? You know, you can take the challenge and let us know. But I was able to run it on Linux. So supposing that the Tampere person can even get access to their cluster in Tampere. So this is how we would do it. So now I'm in the Talta computer, which is a gateway to enter the Alto network, but I'm gonna run this on our Triton cluster. So I SSH triton.alto.fi. I'm trying to go a bit slow so that you are able to do the same. Maybe I make the font. Maybe we don't need Triton because it's quite light. All right, so good suggestion. Let's do it from VDI. I don't know actually if Tampere has a VDI. I know that Helsinki University has a VDI. So I don't know if something like VDI, what is the Tampere this date? Is it tuuni.fi? I don't know if this exists. No, it doesn't exist. Anyway, VDI.alto.fi exists. So if you connect to VDI, let's hope that there's not too many people connected. There are 100 of these virtual machines, so in theory, it's good that we're not too many of us. All right, well, let's ignore my terminals. So now I'm gonna open, you can follow me, I'm trying not to go too fast. You can open a new terminal and then go to your favorite folder. I go to code. I'm doing it from, well, actually, to save time, I go to a folder where I already downloaded. All right, so I went to a folder. This is my folder. You have your own folder, and your task is to get this file here, all right, and unzip it. So from the terminal now, I'm actually going to Ctrl C and copy this. Maybe I'll do it again. Do it from scratch. Okay, so to download on the terminal, we can use the command wget. Now I paste. So you should do the same. You're basically downloading a pre-compiled, the so-called DICOM toolkit, command line tools. This is pre-compiled so that we don't need to compile the code for our Linux version. So I press enter now, and now it's downloading the zip file and it's downloaded. So now if I do ls, let me make the fonts a little bit bigger so that you see better. I do ls, and right now in this folder there is just this zip file. Then I can type unzip and the name of the zip file, and now it extracts all the stuff. It takes some time. It's good to do it together because then I also know how long it would take if you're doing the same. I think the most difficult part is trying to copy and paste from outside VDI to inside VDI. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Now I was lucky enough that when I selected this and clicked Ctrl C and came here and did Ctrl V, it worked, but some other times it basically goes to these VDI options that you have here. If you wanna share the copy paste memory from the local computer with the VDI computer. Alright, but hopefully you were able, at least some of you were able to unzip it. How many managed to unzip it? You can raise your virtual hand or make a sound. Nobody. It's okay. Maybe I should I wait a little bit that you try to unzip it? It works. Okay. So if it worked for one person, I assume that after a while it will work for everyone. So now, yeah, I can paste it even to the so this is the first command that I'm running in the VDI terminal. I paste it in the Zoom chat even so that. And so this wget is basically downloading whatever is in this case a zip file. So this is the first command that I ran, and then the second command was just unzip and the name of the file that I downloaded. And now if I do an ls with these options so that I see better what's inside there. And now there is a folder, this the DICOM toolkit dash linux dash whatever version number. So basically to run these tools, I would need to do, you know, like you would run something in Linux. So then it's in the bin. And then the command that we're gonna use is DICOM dump. So I can also paste this to the Zoom chat. Okay, didn't copy. The shortcuts, by the way, to copy and paste from VDI Linux is a Ctrl Shift and C, Ctrl Shift and V. So this is the command that I'm gonna run now, and this is the tool, the command line tool that is very useful to look at this header of DICOM files. So here there are all the options. Now I didn't pass anything, so it just tells me, you know, whatever, you know, all the parameters. And now of course I wanna test it with an image. So now my data is in M, maybe you have a different path. And then it was in this, yeah. So this is the folder from the from this Zenodo stuff that we downloaded. So now if I do ls, here inside there are all these MR slices. Ignore the JSON file for now because we will do that in a second. I'm one step ahead. So now I keep this full path, okay? And now I'm gonna copy this, the full path of the DICOM file. And now I'm gonna run this DICOM dump command space the full path and then one of the files that are inside there. I first type, then I use the tab. And then, for example, I could take maybe the last one, the 31. All right, so now I can paste the command that I'm going to run on the Zoom chat, so you also have it. And the paste didn't go. Let's try it. Yes, so now this is the so-called DICOM dump of all the header information of this DICOM slice. DICOM image. I press play and I get loads and lots of stuff on the screen. Now I'm gonna make my terminal big and run the command again, and at the end I do this pipe and type less so that I see all the pages. So this is the beginning. There are so many fields, you know, it would take hours to explain why every field is called like this. And it's beyond the course of this, the topic of this course. It would require another course on medical imaging. But basically, you can understand already that the private stuff, or the sum of the sensitive stuff, is in these fields that are called patient, patient name, patient ID, patient birth date, etc. So because this is now a Linux command line, here at the end, let me check it because I don't see it now. Again, with this pipe, instead of typing less, I could type grep. And then, for example, I just write Patty because it's just a string for patient. So now, the DICOM dump output, I'm only grepping, I'm only keeping those entries that contains patient. So, all right, now with one liner, I'm able to basically see, you know, that yes, this DICOM file actually, it requires some anonymization because I see the patient name, Lionheart, William, this whatever ID, let's imagine that this is the social security number, the birth date, you know, there's lots of personal data that we wouldn't like to have. Now, these DICOM tools, command line tools, you can also edit these entries. But what I like, what I prefer to do is that I use them to browse many folders. Now, if I take the same command, if instead of specifying the image, you know, I could specify multiple folders. Now, it's a bit of a silly example because these images, they're all the same. But imagine that you have different images from different subjects. So, and I want to check if the patient name field is empty. So now with the star, I'm gonna run this DICOM dump command with all the images that are there. So I'm kind of checking that all the images have this patient name. And now, yes, actually all the images have the patient name. In this case, I said that it was a bit of a silly example because how DICOM works is that it clones the metadata, so the header, this extra information, it's in every file inside one folder. So they all have the same. But imagine, you know, that somebody gave you this de-identified data and this person was a bit lousy and they only de-identified the image zero, the first one, but then they left the patient name in all the other images. It could be possible. You never know when someone gives you the data. So this is a good check that, you know, that, okay, somebody sent you de-identify DICOM data, make sure that there's no patient name or patient anything. Now I just grab for patient, and then, you know, for every image, now I get, you know, I get a grab of this data. Okay, so now we've been working with DICOM files, and DICOM files have this metadata in the header, plus some, they might have personal data in the actual picture, but often, a nice way of getting rid quickly of all this information is to transform DICOM images into something else. So imagine you have an X-ray image, you could just transform it to a picture, to a bitmap. Because you don't need, you know, if you know that you don't need all these other fields, because you don't need the patient name or the patient ID and whatever, a simple way to de-identify, to anonymize DICOM files is to transform them into a different format. And this is exactly what they decided to do in brain imaging. So the six of you here who are working with brain imaging, am I right? And so it's good to know what people are doing in the brain imaging field. So in brain images, they decided to kind of standardize all this process that goes from the DICOM files to files that are more useful in neuroimaging. And the name of this standards is the so-called BITS. Now, are you all familiar with BITS that I don't need to say anything, or do you want me to quickly? If just one says, please, Enrico, say something about BITS, I will say it. Should I go? Should I tell something? Okay, well then basically, this is exactly, this picture summarizes, you know, what we are doing. Then we got some DICOM folders from the scanner, and there's two issues here. There's the issue that now these folders and these files and these names are not very informative. Nobody knows, unless you can access the DICOM headers, if, you know, is this the T1 weighted image, is this the diffusion image, is this the fMRI, you know, it's impossible to get it from these folders. And then inside these DICOM files, there might be stored this personal information in the header, like we just saw now with this DICOM dump command line tool. So then a good way of, you know, basically putting things in order and getting rid of personal data, the identification is to convert the data into another format, which is this bits structure. So the actual DICOM data gets converted into Nifty, which is another file type for storing volumetric data, especially for, it's used a lot with MRI, but it's also used with PET and with CT. And then the header, so those information that were in the DICOM header that we just now looked at them with this DICOM dump tool, the header can actually be, where did it go? The header can actually be stored as a JSON. So the idea of this JSON is that it's serialized. So it's like it's a file format that is readable by a machine, but it's also readable by a human. So it's a useful way of storing important information, let's say about the acquisition parameters, because, you know, when you collect MRI or in general images, DICOM images, there might be some settings in the scanner that you still wanna keep, you know. You might wanna get rid of the patient name or the patient ID and whatever, but you still wanna keep some settings that you use to collect the data. And so from DICOM to Nifty, we can actually split the DICOM so that the actual data, the images, are gonna be stored in the Nifty file, and the metadata, the header, are gonna be stored in the JSON without all this personal information. So the best tool to do that is to use this this DCM to NIX. So now we could do together, we could install it together and compile it together. It's a good exercise. And after doing that, we are able to run it on these images that we got from this Zenodo link. So now I'm gonna write here how to install DCM to NI or NIX. So DCM to NI is another tool from the same guy, but we use the X. And the one with the X has an option to automatically create these bits compatible data. Okay, so I already did this, of course, and I can show you what I was running. And then I can paste this code so you can test it yourself. Okay, so now I'm gonna add this to the everything in there. It's easy for you then to copy and paste the, and I think it's if it allows me to put some color. Alright, so basically the commands that I'm gonna run here, I'm not sure myself if this is going to work in the VDI system, but we can give it a try, because I'm not sure if VDI has CMake, but eventually we can connect to Triton and run it from there. So I'm gonna make a new folder so that I'm not gonna mess the previous test that I did. And I call it test DCM to NIX. And then I go inside this new folder. And then once I'm here, now we can run those commands for installing it. So the first command here is basically getting the repository, the remote repository. And so I paste that. And now it's getting the repository in my local folder here. Oh, it's doing all the commands now. All right. It seems that it's working actually. So the module load, like this bit of the module load, this would be needed if you do it on Triton, because by default, Triton doesn't see, for example, the command CMake. But in this VDI system, it looks like that there was already a CMake. So long story short, you can run on VDI, you can skip this module load, But if you run it on Triton, you need the module load. And now it's running. And now it looks like everything went successfully. So now that is in the folder where I am right now, this really long path. If you don't see the path with your terminal, you can type pwd. And now here there's a bin folder. So I can do this dot slash bin slash pcm2mix. And this is now the command is running. So here you get the help from the command. And specifically, the option that we want to set is the option B, that we want to generate the so-called bits format so that it has a nifty and also this, how do you call it, JSON metadata, and also anonymize. So now let's get back to our, let me find where the original data I had from Zenodo. So my Zenodo data was in Scratch, RenData, and S. All right. So I make sure, because I already ran it before, that I delete the JSON file that I have there. All right. So now I can run basically DCM or Bing DCM to Nix. I want to use the option for the bits and the option for anonymization. Then I specify, I need to say if I want to use these things, I need to say yes. And then I put the full path of the folder that contains all these DICOM images of this head. So now this is the command. I can also paste it on some, and maybe I paste it on the web page. Okay. And now with this command, we are basically able to convert the DICOM files into nifty format and also create this metadata. So now I press play, and that was quite fast. So now by default, this DCM to me, it didn't specify any, I didn't specify any name of the output. I could have given it an informative name. If it's able to find a good name, it tries to, for example, use some information that is in the DICOM header. In this case, now I go to the folder where it's stored. Well, actually, in this case, it gave it a good name. Earlier, when I was doing a test, it didn't. So it's a T1 weighted, so you know it's a little bit more informative already. Maybe this is the date when the data were collected. I'm just guessing now. But now you see that we still have, okay, the 31 DICOM files, but now we have one nifty file that is a zipped nifty and the JSON file. So now we can open, we can have a look at the JSON file. More. And so this is what I meant that it's machine readable, because now all this stuff was stored in the DICOM header, and we needed to, you know, install these DICOM tools and run stuff from the terminal, or install this DICOM browser and look at these things graphically. But now this is just a text file. I'm opening from the terminal, you know, but I wouldn't even need the terminal. If I would open this folder with the graphical interface, I would see it here, and I would be able to open it with, let's say, Atom, some text editor that I have installed in my system. So that, I don't know what's doing, but so basically the point here is that the advantage of leaving DICOM behind, if you don't really need it anymore, the people working with Brain Imagy, they were quite clever that switching to Nifty and having this information human readable is much more handy. And now the CMTNX, because we passed the option of anonymizing, has already stripped all that name and surname and whatever, you know. Then of course it's still our task to make sure that, you know, this data corresponds to subject one. And that's now the part of the bits format, you know, that then you would need to prepare the folders. And, you know, for example, that this one that you converted is subject one, and then you put it in the right location. Specifically, this would be in the anatomy folder. But it's very handy because now you already have the JSON file ready for, you know, bits that contains all this information that can be useful, you know, the type of scan and whatever, you know, things that you also see sometimes reported in the papers. Okay, so how much minute do we have? We still have 20 minutes. I hope you were able, or at least understood, how to do the CM2NIX. And now that we have an IFTTT file, now we want to actually now do defacing, so remove the face. So it's at least most of the tools that are doing defacing, they are working with IFTTT files, because it's a very popular image, kind of neuro image format, and because it's the kind of audience that most likely is working with the neuro imaging. There is most likely also a tool that doesn't require the conversion to IFTTT, but at least for those in the room who are working with brain imaging and neuro imaging, the IFTTT tools are, defacing tools are all working with IFTTT. So after doing the DC, the DICOM to IFTTT, you wanna run this defacing. Now, we only have 20 minutes, I don't know, or less. I don't know if we have time to run deface. But at this link here that I'm now opening, there's a list of tools for, you know, as they say it here, elimination of facial and dental features. This is part of the Open Brain Concert initiative. I'm actually one of the contributors there. So that, you know, we can hopefully, especially in Europe, start sharing and working with openly with the brain images and images collected for neuroscience, this GDPR edition, I'm one of the authors. But anyway, to the actual practical tool, so there are many tools that are doing this defacing of the images, and once again, I'm not recommending one against the other. Me, myself, I've been using MRI Deface. It works quite well with images from the AMI Center, from the Alto AMI Center. Pi Deface is done by the same people of fMRI Prep. MRI Defacer is Michael Anke from Germany. So, you know, there are multiple tools doing similar things. We only have 15 minutes now, so I don't think we have time to run one. But if you want to test MRI deface, and let's say you are on VDI again, so in practice you need to download this, and then you need to download these two templates. And what MRI face does is that it takes the IFTTT file with the full face, and then based on these two templates is trying to find basically what the nose and the eyes are, and then kind of erode, get rid of those part from the MRI, so that it removes these bits from the MRI image. So once you've downloaded this and this and this file, you just copy paste these commands in the terminal, and then you can run it like this. So MRI deface, name of your IFTTT file, the name of these templates, and then some name for the output. I already did it for you. I think I might still have it open here in VDI. And with this data from Zenodo, it wasn't that good, which kind of brings us back to the, I don't think I have it open anymore. Maybe I closed it. Was it here? Just quickly check if I have the window that I was running it. Maybe it was for this, yeah. So it wasn't too good. So now I open, I used another tool for looking at Nifty files, but you can pick your favorite tool. So now this is the data for this Zenodo that we used. And now anterior is here, posterior is there, so the nose is here, basically. And so you see it was, is it, it now everything is black where the nose is and the mouth is. So this tool was able to identify the nose and the mouth, but the eyes, you see, the eyes are still there. So, you know, it wasn't very successful with this image. I have to say that this data from Zenodo actually was quite a low resolution data. They only had 32 slices. So with data from AMI Center, MRI Deface performs much better and is really able to get rid of this, basically of all this non-brain stuff. But of course, you know, it might be that with some subject it might fail. This is why the manual inspection is always needed. Don't trust the tool. I know that it can be annoying if you need to deface 100 subjects, that you need to manually open them and check that, you know, that there's no eyes and no mouth. But I don't think there's any better way. Okay, so maybe in the last 10 minutes, there are still some, well, there are some MATLAB options for those of you who like MATLAB, and maybe some of you, especially those working with NEG and EEG, are familiar with the Field Trip toolbox. So in with Field Trip, there are options to basically get rid of or de-identify these DICOM images of the head. In general, also, is that, yeah, maybe the last thing that we can talk about in the last 5 minutes is the consideration of medical time series. So at least few of you wrote, or if not actually all of you, you are right working with time series. Some people have MRI time series, meaning fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging. Some people using EEG, some people using MEG, and some people even mention some heart time series, ECG. So in my opinion, the state of, you know, the state where we are right now with the medical time series is that good luck with anonymizing them. It's if you, like, there are techniques for de-identifying time series, but basically time series are a fingerprint. Whether it's a brain time series or a, you know, heart rate time series, you can re-identify an individual. So I'm not recommending any specific tool for de-anonymizing de-identifying time series, because in my opinion they destroy the data so much that you're not able to actually do what you should do. But in general, what people do is that they model the time series like this ARIMA models, so that you replace the time series with some sort of a, you know, modeled version of the time series. Another are these n-grams. So if you really want to explore this with medical time series, you can start looking, let's say, n-grams time series anonymization. And there are some paper, you know, that are using some tools to preserve the anonymization time series. In my opinion, at least when it comes to brain time series, that's where I'm an expert, they destroy the data so much that it doesn't make any sense to use them there. But of course, you can still work on aggregated, you know, that, imagine that. I don't know, for those of you who work with MEG and EEG, maybe some of you work with this event-related potential or whatever they are, event-related fields. So there you can still kind of this grand average over many, many trials, it starts to get very difficult to re-identify an individual. But even there, you know, why playing the risk? Where you can just call it personal data, make sure that you work in a secure way, and that's about it. And then briefly in the last 10 minutes, I mentioned that in my experience over the years, I never came across MEG or EEG data that contains these type of identifiers. Then maybe the issue is that, or maybe the reason is that often the tools that people use in neuroimaging to work with the EEG or MEG data is that they do not really store much from the header of the files. But in general, there is also the issue that there are so many formats of EEG and MEG. Well, MEG a bit less, but EEG there are many formats. So, you know, just be careful and think of your case. If you're collecting data at Alto with the MEG core, with what we have here at Alto, you know, nobody stores this name and surnames inside the header of this MEG file, so you should be fine. But if you get data from somewhere else, I point here two tools that are kind of taking care of this. One is a Python based from the MNE suite, and the other is again from Fieldtrip. So if you use other tools like EEG Lab, you can also, I'm sure that EEG Lab allows you to explore the header and check if there's any personal data. So I wanted to leave the last 10 minutes for interactive questions. I can even stop recording in case somebody feels